happened during that time, we would have been in Moscow before they got to Washington. And as we were told, it was our job to see that they had nothing to go back to. I'm saying all of that just to show you the tip of the iceberg of the mighty military power that this country still possesses. And now, since they don't have the Russians to fight, why don't they fight the enemy within? Why don't they stop the drugs? They've got planes that cost more than $1 billion apiece. Well, for one reason, some of these cowboy presidents get votes by running over somewhere else, way over yonder, when right here in the hood, drugs are eating us up. Let me hear you say, we've got to do something about it. Along here now. But do I have you thinking? Yes. Am I making you think? Yes. And I told those men in prison, back to that again, you have the power. You have the responsibility to change your life. Well, what can I do here behind these bars? Well, one thing, you are free to think. Say it. As long as I am free to think, I can free myself from any condition. That's just another way of quoting Paul in the 12th chapter of Romans. Be not conformed to this world, but be you transformed. You see, in the world they are conformers and transformers. Those conformers say, well, they say I'm black, so I gotta have sickle cell. I don't even know how to fix my mouth to say that. And because I'm black, I can't do this, and I can't do that, and I can't do the other. No, I'm not gonna conform to that. I remember when I first went on television, in those days I had to keep a director of public relations. He was a Jewish gentleman, and he called me one day and he said, you know, the newspaper in Chicago, we went on television out there Sunday, and the newspaper called from Chicago and said, why does Reverend Ike tell those people they can have all these things when he knows that they can't have all these things? They get upset when we wake up. But I'm not gonna sleep to please anybody. Let me begin my conclusion, but never take an evangelist seriously when he says that. How do we stop self-victimization? And we need to address that. Because the enemy is within. On the national, international level, we no longer have the Russians to fight. The Russian Empire has been dismantled. But the enemy is within. Unfortunately, in just the drive-by shooting, the homeboys in the hood have killed more black people than the Ku Klux Klan ever did. Let me hear you say, we can't let that happen. So let's not get so caught up on that enemy without that we forget about that enemy within. Someone, there's an old quotation that says, we have seen the enemy and it is us. Thank you. We must stop the self-victimization. There's an interesting quotation. It's provocative. And here it is, and I'll have you repeat it after me, and you just let it dangle and see what you can do with it. If you can't handle it, throw it away. And that quotation is this: there are no victims, only volunteers. Whether you agree with it or not, it provokes you, doesn't it, to think? There are no victims, only volunteers. Let's hear it.
There are no victims, only volunteers.
You know, even if you have an abusive husband, you're volunteering to be his punching bag. Suggest that we stop volunteering to fill up those jails that they're going to build. And I want to quote something that I read from Bishop Bernard Jordan this morning on one of his tape cassettes. Destiny is a matter of choice, not chance. Let's say it. Destiny is a matter of choice, not chance. You see, victims live by chance. Masters live by choice. Victims have bad luck. For years, people misunderstood me, especially the saints, whoever they are. On radio and television, for several years, I offered the secret of good luck. Why? Because the world believes in luck, and I dared to address it. And the saints went off on me. They'd even let you know you can't even conform to the saints. Not only the ain'ts, but the saints either. They'll have you pushing when you ought to be shoving. And what makes a master is when you come to know and exercise your power of choice. When you discover you have the power of choice, it makes no difference what you believe I should have and I should not have. I realize that I've got the power to choose. I have the power to decide. Oh, that brings in a commercial. Where are those tapes? Bring those tapes up here. Why are they back there? All my tapes, by the way, are going to be 50% off the first 10 minutes after the service. Right here, right here, right here. All of them, yeah. What do you think I brought them for? No. All right, leave them with me. Listen. Because there's a chapter in here titled Decisions, Decisions, Decisions. Let's hear it. Now you see, weak-minded people don't like to make choices and decisions. Laser-minded people. Nobody here's like that. But your destiny is a matter of choice. You don't have to leave it up to dumb luck. Again, when I was 17 years old and came to New York, and had minus nothing. I used to love to walk. down Central Park South and on to Fifth Avenue in the direction of Barnwood Teller and look in the windows. And I saw these funny looking cars that I'd never seen in Ridgeland, South Carolina. And I went a little closer and I read it. It said Rolls Royce. Now there I was, I didn't have a dime to ride the subway, but I saw that and I said, I like that and I choose to have some. Here's the beautiful thing. You know, a lot of people think that you gotta have money to start. All you have to have is a mind and make a choice. Let me hear you say, choice is my starting point. What did the bishop say again? Well, you know that here, huh? You must have heard of him. Now, I hope you don't think that that's just a beautiful saying. You see, that's why some people don't get anything out of the scriptures. They think that the scriptures are so beautiful. And they fight over the inerrant word of God. Just like some people I know that fight over the name of Jesus. I'm not going to fight over the name. I'm going to use the name. Say, I have the power of choice. I have the power of decision. This book is half price tonight, first 10 minutes after. I say first 15 minutes after the service. All kinds of good stuff in here. It tells you about the psychology of money. You can make a choice to have money. That's where it begins. But some people never make that choice. You know why? Because they've been told by religion and by the world that money is nasty and dirty. But that particular day, I saw that car over there. I didn't know what it was. I only know what I liked. And you see, that's another thing you have to do. And there, somewhere in this book, it tells you four ways to get what you want. One of the ways to get what you want is know what the heaven you want. You can't even choose until you know what you want. Read about your power of decision. And yes, when I made that decision, you see, that's what a lot of people would have said. You see, you cannot make your choices and decisions out of appearance. We walk by faith. Not by sight. What does it have to do with I don't have any money? Choose it and it'll choose you. Say that with me. Choose it. And do you know, to date, 20-some Rolls Royces have come through my life. And listen, and some of you know they said I shouldn't have them. But that has nothing to do with it. It was my choice. If you choose poverty, that's your blessed business. Jesus said he shall have whatsoever he says. something else also about prosperity and so on. You have really got to have the psychology that will not let what other people think bother you. There I was with not a dime to get on the subway, but here I am choosing to have some Rolls Royces. That's where they started. It's like the old song from down Georgia, the preacher sings, "You don't know what the Lord told me. The Lord told me to choose what I want. The Lord told me make a decision. I brought the Master of Money course. And if you've been afraid of money, you don't have to be afraid of it anymore. Master it. Even the Ten Commandments of money are here. Do you know money has Ten Commandments? A lot of things it tells you about money that they don't tell y'all. Like money has ears. Money hears what you say. When you say money is hard to get, money hears you and said, okay. When you say, I ain't got no money, money says, I ain't going near him. And another thing, money is a woman. And if you don't know how to treat her, she can be a mean mother. But money is a high class woman. Don't be saying all kinds of things about her. And you know, a high class woman, if she hears you saying naughty things about her, she wants nothing to do with you. Thou art ensnared by the words of thy mouth. So you better get this money course. You've got the Master Prosperity course. They didn't want y'all to know this. Prosperity, your divine right. Your power of employment and compensation. A young lady out in California told me the last seminar I had out there how when she was a teenager, she played this tape, Your Power of Employment and Compensation. And she was a teenager going to college, and she chose to have a Mercedes. And she said, that Mercedes came into her life and the cops stopped her all the time because it was a young black teenage girl driving a Mercedes. And you know, they're not supposed to do that. But I've got news for you. God's people are always doing what the world said they shouldn't do and having what the world said they shouldn't have. And this was the answer to that reporter in Chicago. You can have it. And another thing, don't be indifferent toward money. I was counseling one of my high-class matriarchs out in Beverly Hills some years ago, back in the 70s. And she came and said to me that her husband was very wealthy, left her very wealthy, but the money got away from her. And, you know, I listened to a person about 1 minute, and usually before 60 seconds, I got him. I know what the problem is. And she said that somebody had offered her a job, and she was wondering what to charge them. She says, oh, but money doesn't matter. I said, ah, that's your problem. That's why I left you. Don't you ever let that come out of your mouth. It does matter. You're lying anyhow. Master of money, it's out there. Control your life, because you see, if you don't control your life, they will control it. Well, I'm winding up now. The power of a made-up mind. make your choices, when you make your decisions, and you choose what you want to be, to do, and to have, the power of a made-up mind is the power of God. And I love this one, how to prosper regardless of world conditions. You see, that's another thing. I love that first song. It doesn't matter what happens in the world. It only matters what happens in your mind. Tell that to each other. It doesn't matter what happens in the world. It only matters what happens in your mind. This is one that says, stop holding yourself down, punishing yourself, drawing bad luck, misfortune. Set yourself free. I'll tell you this, and I'm coming closer to the end. Somewhere around between now and sunrise. Here it is. This is going to set a lot of people free. Are you ready? You only need to give yourself permission. To be, to do, and to have. You don't have what you don't have because you haven't yet given yourself permission. You are nobody's victim but your own. We victim of your own. Our organist here, he told me about it. I'll have to have him tell the whole church, but he told me backstage. I came out of church, you know, this is about his, I guess, second Sunday there. When I came out of church getting in my Rolls Royce, I saw him driving by in this jalopy. You didn't know it then, son, but I said, what a disgrace. Up here playing and jumping and shouting and got the holy goose and had a ride on the roller coaster. On my way to heaven anyhow. If I can just make it in. How you gonna make it in like that? Your old car ain't gonna make it to the ground. I didn't tell you then, son, but I was embarrassed. So I yelled at him. I said, hey!
The other side.
What kind of car do you want? He said, any kind. I said, they don't make that kind. Listen to what the bishop tells you. You see, some of you haven't even made a choice. You're just shucking and jiving. And ain't nobody can shuck and jive like colored folks. Every time one of them tell me, I said, where have you been? I haven't seen you in church for a long time. Well, I'm going to try to get there. They ain't going to be there. They're going to try something, forget it. Now, what was I about? I said, give yourself permission or something else. I said, oh, yes, that's, yeah, it was David right there. Was embarrassed. He's playing the organ up there on my platform. Here I am in my Italian suit and my gaiters. Fresh out of the swamp. He comes chugging up in this thing while I'm getting in my Rolls Royce. Blasphemy! Let me, everybody say blasphemy! I mean, hey, let's be real. Listen, what kind of car do you want, son? Any kind. They don't make that kind. See? Now, again, that's evading choice. So I think it was like about the next Sunday, I got a hold of him right on the pavement before I got into my car. And I cornered him and made him say what kind he wanted. After he got through spunning, my credit ain't so good. Got no money. Was that the week you made a choice? You decided, and you got yourself a car in spite of bad credit? The power of choice. The power of a made up mind. Okay, what am I gonna close on now? Let's stand. We're going to apply this in my closing. We can stop the victimization of minorities, of blacks and Hispanics, and men. When we learn how to use our minds, when we learn how to be decisive people. You see, that's another thing they taught us. Don't be so choosy. Uh-oh, did I hit a nerve that time? Anybody ever told you don't be so choosy? And here's the other one, beggars can't be choosy. Who the heaven is a beggar? I'm a child of the king. Reminds me of that blind man. I know he was a black man. Just by what he said, you can listen. I can tell him every time. He heard Jesus was coming by. He was blind. And so he started yelling out, "Oh, Jesus, thou Son of David, have mercy on me." Now listen, people, ain't nothing wrong with mercy. Sometimes we all need some mercy. Most of you do. But he wasn't being specific. In this book, Reverend Ike says you've got to be definite with the infinite. Say to each other, you got to be definite with the infinite. Satan. Yeah, God's infinite, but that ain't good enough. You got to be definite with the infinite. So this man, oh, Jesus, thou Son of David, his theology was right. His Christology was right. Jesus, he had the lineage right. You see, that's why sometimes religious people can be so right and yet be so wrong. Because they don't know how to apply the principle. They don't know how to apply the word. People will argue about that word as long as it stays right there in the book. Oh yeah, that's the word. This is the word of God here. And they go to church every night with it up under their arms, and it never gets any further. word itself says that the word of God is alive, 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 alive. Every one of you should be like Jesus, the living word. Let me hear you say, I am the living word. I am the walking, talking, loving, living word of God. Oh, how nice and religious. But he got nothing. Finally, Jesus said, go bring that fellow over here. And he comes just praying. Oh, just praying. You see, it goes to show it's not enough even to pray those nice prayers. I have a prayer, not so nice. I got one that has two words. It works wonders. Hell no. Some of you don't even know what you prayed for. Oh, if thou please, if it be thy will. Well, you ought to be clear on that first. The Bible says we must know what the will of the Lord is. What has he told us, beloved? Sister thinks, no matter what the church folks think, beloved, I wish. And listen, it's not a weak wish. I'm going home on the morning train.
that evening train, I'd be too late. I'm going home on the morning train. Now, wait a minute. Wait a minute. We'll go to Lovely Hill Baptist Church again in just a moment here. Let me hear you say, yeah. Yeah. Clap your hands and say, I receive it. Wait a minute, I've got something else.
All right.
I've got something else that I want you to have. Lord, have mercy. Some of you just don't have the guts to have what God wants you to have. You haven't given yourself permission. But he said, above all things, I want you to be in good health. You don't have to be like the man told me down in Florida, oh, Reverend Mike, I want you to pray for me. I got rheumatism and I got and then he said, of course you know, I'm in my 70s and about the age now where I'm due to have these things. I said, well, what you come here for? Matter of fact, that's not exactly the way I told him. I said, then what the hell you come here for then? I'm a healer. Let me hear you say, I'm a healer. Say it again, I'm a healer. Say it again. See, that's a belief that you got to get out of your belief system. I'm not due to be sick. I'm due to be well. Come on, you get it. There are healings taking place all over here right now. Come on and say it. I'm not due to be sick. I'm due to be well. Wait a minute here. Beloved, I wish above all things. Lord, if God wants it for me, all I gotta say is lay it on me, Lord. Let's get it all laid on here. I mean, you know, you think I look good at 60? Wait until I hang around till I'm 160. I got out of the car the other day to go and see Lady Clairol. There's a young girl on the bicycle. She came over. She said, aren't you the Reverend? I said, yes. She said, you look good. I said, well, what am I supposed to look like? Beloved, I wish above all things that you would be in health and that you would prosper. Ooh, my. Just like your soul prospers. I want you to prosper inside. I want you to prosper outside. Now, you know, health is more than just bodily health. Health is total well-being. So that you can truly lift your hands and say, it is well. I'm closing now, but I want you to know this truth. To set you free. The Christian church is waiting for Jesus to come through the sky to set him free. Now, the other day, the Holy Spirit revealed something to me that's also rather heretical. You know, when Jesus ascended, the angel said, "Now, you men of Galilee, why do you stand there gazing at the sky?" They haven't stopped gazing yet. Church, still looking. Why did he say that? He said, "Now, why are you standing there gazing at the sky?"
I'm here for a good time, not a long time, you know, I...
So now this saying, Jesus,
had a good time, not a long time, you know, I...
That's taken up from you into heaven is coming again in like manner. Well, now, they have absolutely taught us something wrong about that. If he coming in like manner meant he was coming back through the blue ether, why did he tell them and rebuke them for gazing up at the sky? You see, my heretical interpretation is that Jesus comes again in like manner in you, through you, as you, in your flesh. You are to be the second coming. That's why he has not come again yet as you suppose. Because you're gazing up into the sky. And he said, "How come you're doing that?" And such respected Christians have set dates. One of the latest ones is the head of the Christian Family Network set a date. Respected Christian minister in his 70s. And the date he set, you know, the man didn't show up. Gazing at the sky. It is in you and through you and as you. He said to you and to me, "Go ye into all the world, preach the gospel." And the greater works shall you do. We got television. We've got radio. We've got the printed word in circulation. Those technologies were not developed when the Christ was here as Jesus. But you see, the Christ is here as you. Another thing that the theologians didn't understand was when Paul heard the voice of Jesus on the Damascus Road saying, "I am Jesus," that was self-revelation, not theology. That's why it knocked him off of his beast, knocked him off of his human identity. You got to get knocked off of your human identity and come to the self-revelation. I am Jesus. Not with ego, for no man can say that Jesus is the Christ, but by the Holy Ghost. When you find out who you are in God,
and who God is in you. It sets you free. You're no longer a victim. You're self-responsible. And you give yourself permission. Place your hands up. Now, and we're going to close this out with an affirmation of self-permission. You see, and a lot of you, it's nobody else holding you back. It's nothing else holding you back. You got to give yourself permission. You got to cut yourself loose. If you want a Rolls Royce, give yourself permission. And turn a deaf ear to those who think you shouldn't have it. Now, of course, when you get all these things, there may be some worldly-minded people around to try to get them from you. I've had lawsuits against me, including one present one, for over $100 million. But nobody can lie that well to get that much money from me. Come on, let's cut yourself loose. Set yourself free. See, the work has already been done. God's will has already been spoken. I want you to have good health. I want you to have prosperity. I want you to prosper even as your soul prospers. As Brother Robert says it, I want your outer man to prosper as your inner man prospers. So come on, let's cut ourselves loose. Are you ready to give yourself permission? You see, there's some things you've been wanting to do. You haven't been waiting on, and you don't need to wait on anybody. See, like, you don't have to wait on the church, because the church is hung up in certain clauses of the word. Yeah, like I told my church Sunday, you know, there's a scripture. Beloved, now are we the sons of God. All right, that's about the first independent clause. Now, there's the next clause that comes along. You can get hung up in there with the rest of the church if you want to. It does not yet appear. I refuse to get hung up in that clause. What we shall be. Hey, I'm back in that first one. Beloved, what now? And the Son of God is entitled to everything. We're the Son of God when? Now. Let's stay in that clause. Okay, right here and right now. I give myself permission to be all that God says I am. No matter who doesn't like it, I don't care. Right here and right now, I give myself permission.
Right here, right now, I give myself permission.
To do all the good that God desires in my heart to do.
I give myself permission.
I'm not asking them.
They can't stop me.
It's my choice.
It's my decision.
Right here and right now.
I give myself permission
to do all the good.
To do.
It is so.
It cannot be otherwise.
And I rejoice because of it.
Thank you, Father.
It is well.
Yeah.
most people would be looking at the man. Oh, this is that wealthy black preacher with all those Rolls Royces he talks about. But who is Reverend Ike? Not the body. Reverend Ike is the mind.
I met Reverend Ike, first of all, he was a famous speaker and preacher over the radio from Boston, Massachusetts, back in the late 50s and 60s. And I used to hear him, but I had no idea really what he was.
First time I heard about Reverend Ike, he was promoting, I believe it was his second meeting at the